where many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you know we lift your name on high.
Well, good evening, Crossville First Baptist. Hope everybody has enjoyed the snow today. I tell you, I wish it had stayed around on everything except for the roads. If it had just stayed, I would have really enjoyed it. I wanted to get my sled out and go sledding. But the last time I did that, I went headfirst into a tree, and Bonnie says that I wasn't quite right before then, but I really have not been quite right since then. But so I guess it's probably better that we didn't. But I hope everybody enjoyed the snow today. Let's gather together for a time where we just worship the Lord together, where we proclaim His Word, and where we're able just to enjoy praising the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise and glorify You. Lord, we thank You that we're able to gather together, whether it's here in this place or just through the technology that You've given us. Lord, we pray that tonight that You will let us worship You, and we pray that You will let Your Word truly change us and mold us and make us more in the image of Your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Y'all stand as we worship. And you out there, you better be singing too. You worship with us.
We are so
we are so
We are strongest.
I've got to say is somebody must need what the Lord's going to say tonight, because it seems like Satan's doing everything he can to make sure that it doesn't get out.
Right.
You know, I've always sort of had the idea that every time that I stand behind a pulpit, that it is important. I've heard some pastors say, well, you know, Sunday mornings is like prime time, and, you know, Sunday nights and Wednesday nights are not a big deal. But you know what? I think any time that you're sharing the Word of God, it's a big deal. And I always try to give my best every single time.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord and let's just ask that He speak to us tonight. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful that You haven't allowed the evil one to overcome Your church, Your Word. He can fuss, he can fight, he can put up an incredible fight, but at the end of the day, You're the King. Lord, we ask that You've been worshipped through song tonight. We ask that tonight that Your Word will reach out and it will accomplish what it is intended to accomplish in the hearts and minds of everyone that hears it. Not just tonight, but tomorrow or whenever someone that may join us online. Lord, we pray that You will use Your Word to save the lost. That You will use Your Word to correct those of us that are believers and draw us closer to You. And mold us and make us more to the image of Your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You know what? We talked this morning about the two spiritual spirals. The spiritual spiral that leads upward, that God uses to mold and make us more into the image of His Son. And we're going to talk more about that next week as we get into the actual study of the fruit of the Spirit. But we also talked about the downward spiritual spiral that pulls us away from the Lord. And this downward spiritual spiral is a result of the works of the flesh as described in Galatians chapter 5. And the Bible gives us a description of this downward spiritual spiral that pulls people away from the Lord in several different places. One place in particular is interesting because it is in Romans, the first chapter of Romans, where it describes the downward spiritual spiral in the life of an unbeliever. But there's a second place in Ephesians that can describe the downward spiritual spiral in the life of a believer. And it starts with the Holy Spirit telling the Apostle Paul to tell us, this is what you don't need to do. And if you'll think about it, the Bible does this several times. The Word tells us what we need to do, and the Word also tells us what we don't need to do. But both places start in the same place, and that's with a heart problem. In Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 9 to 10, the Word of God says, the heart is more deceitful than all else, and it is desperately sick, desperately wicked. Who can understand it? And then God answers the question, I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, and even to give to each man according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. And that's exactly where it starts. It starts with a heart problem. It starts with the heart of man. And you see, for the unbeliever, it comes from a heart that is dead and that is trapped in sin. Because like we talked about this morning, people want to talk about it. They want freedom. They want a choice. But I've got news for you. For the unsaved, there is no choice. You're a slave to sin. You're a captive to sin. You can't please God. And all your righteousness is just like filthy rags. And for the believer, it comes from a heart that's lost its first love. It's lost its first love and needs to repent and to return to the Lord. And one of the ways that you know that you've lost your first love, your love for the Lord, is when your thoughts and your desires turn from Him to yourself. You basically take a very important passage and you flip it into a mirror version of itself. You reverse this passage. In Luke chapter 9, verses 23 to 24, Jesus is speaking and he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. Well, the heart that's lost its first love, its love for Jesus, is the heart that won't deny itself. It won't deny itself what it wants, and it will follow its own desires rather than following Jesus. It will live for its own fulfillment rather than to die to their own desires and to live for Christ. And this is sort of the start. When your focus is on yourself rather than on Christ and others, because this focus begins to lead to thoughts and actions that pull you further down that downward spiritual spiral. And let's turn our Bibles now to Ephesians chapter 4 as we look at this downward spiritual spiral. Ephesians 4, verses 17 to 19. Ephesians 4, verses 17 to 19. The Word of God says this: "So this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you," meaning you believers, those who have died to themselves, who have been born again and are following Jesus, "that you no longer walk just as the Gentiles ought walk, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart, and they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness." Now, remember this morning we had a positive command. Basically, do this. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. If you remember this morning, Galatians 5, verse 16 was a positive command. It said, do this. What did it say that we're to do? "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh." Well, here is a negative command, which is the opposite, showing what is opposite of walking by the Spirit. And it's a warning to all believers of what you do not need to do. But here's the thing. How do you tell when you're in that downward spiritual spiral? This is a warning sign. I'm the type of guy, I grew up back in the old days when you wanted gauges on your car because they were directly tied into your engine, where you had an oil line that actually went to an oil pressure gauge that showed you what the oil pressure was. You know, where you had a temperature gauge that was hooked directly up. Now, a lot of stuff now comes through computers, and I've been told that in some vehicles that the gauges really don't matter. They're just kind of there to make you feel good about it. But I'm sort of old school. I like gauges. The lights that light up, I always hate it. You know why? Because by the time that light was lit up, whatever you had a problem with was already bad. Okay, I like a gauge so I can see what's going on. Well, that's kind of what this passage is. It's kind of like a checklist, like a gauge that helps you figure out where you are spiritually and shows you, are you on a downward spiritual spiral? And if so, how far down are you? Because this morning I asked the question, which one of these two spirals are you on? And there's probably some people said, well, I'm on this one. And some people said, well, I'm on that one. And also there's probably a lot of people said, you know, I don't really know. So let's look at this warning sign from Ephesians. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. "So this I say, and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk, in the futility of their mind." The Holy Spirit is saying, do not live your life like an unbeliever. This phrase Gentiles here is not just talking about those that are non-Jews. It's having the mindset of basically referring to Gentiles as the unsaved. So it's saying, don't live your life like an unbeliever. Because when you do, the desires of your heart move you one step down the spiral into this. No Notice you walk no longer as the Gentiles walk. How do the Gentiles walk? In the futility of their mind. That's the first step on that downward spiral, is the futility of their mind. What does that mean? It means the desires of the heart that move you one step down into an empty, spiritually meaningless kind of thought life. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3 says, among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of our flesh and the desires of our mind. And we're by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. You see, when you indulge the desire of your flesh and your worldly thoughts, looking back at Ephesians 4, verse 17, you are walking in the futility of your mind. Thoughts that are focused only on pleasing yourself and therefore are spiritually meaningless. They are empty of all truth. Your thought life is futile. And you have moved one step further down the spiral and away from the Lord, because your thoughts now are basically spiritually meaningless. Then in Ephesians 4, 17 to 18, let's kind of put things together. The Spirit says, so this I say, and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their heart. You see, a believer that has stopped thinking about God and started thinking about only how they can pleasure themselves, their thoughts have become futile, spiritually worthless to them, and they move one step down. Then what happens once your thoughts are spiritually meaningless? You move another step down, being darkened in your understanding. What does that mean? It means living in sin out of the will and truth of God's word. And it means causing you to not even understand anymore, to be darkened in the idea of truth and error. You can't tell the difference. Your mind is darkened. The light of God's word is no longer shining within you. You know, years ago, I was in a movie theater back when I was dating. And me and one of my buddies, we went to the movie down here at Colin. And I never will forget, because I sat here, and my little girl I was with sat here, and the little girl that my buddy was with sat right there, and he sat all the way down on the end. And you know, we were in a darkened movie, and I thought I was going to be all slick and everything. And I kind of yawned and stretched and kind of put my arm around her. And she reached up kind of like this and grabbed my hand. Well, you know, a little while later, you know, she wanted some popcorn, so she let go of my hand, and I just had my arm kind of propped around the thing. And all of a sudden, I felt her grab it again. And I was sitting there, you know, and all of a sudden, I said, boy, she's got some calloused hands. She must be a hard-working woman. And I thought, doggone, she got some big old hands like that. And all of a sudden, I looked over, and about that time, the movie kind of flared up, we could see, and I was holding my buddy's hand. Boy, you ain't never seen two boys get their hand down as fast. You know, girl's like,
what's the matter?
And I'm like, it's okay, I'm all right, you know. And, you know, it was dark. I couldn't see, okay? I couldn't see. I remember thinking, boy, that girl needs to put some lotion on her hands. You know what? When you're spiritually darkened in your mind to where you can't see what's in the dark, you can't see the truth, the light of God, or the error that God's truth exposes, you're spiritually blind. That means you're unable to see the truth and to choose the upward way towards the Lord. Ephesians 1:18 says this about this very thing. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. You see, when your spiritual eyes are darkened, you can't see the hope of your calling. You can't see the riches and the glory of God. And it gets even worse because look back at Ephesians 4, 17 and 18. Because once you're darkened in your understanding and you move another spiral down, then you also become excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them. Because the heart is the heart. Excluded from the life of God. Now for unbelievers, that's the way the Gentiles walk. They're excluded from the Holy Spirit's power. They're excluded from all the wisdom that God has. But folks, when we start, even if we're saved and we start living like that, when we become darkened in our understanding, then we become excluded from the life of God. Now that doesn't mean we lose our salvation. That's not what I'm saying at all. But what it means is you are separated, excluded from having that deep spiritual relationship with the Lord. You're separated. Why? It's not that God won't work in you. It's that you won't allow Him to work in you. It means that you keep the Holy Spirit from growing that fruit of the Spirit within you. It means that you're not able to allow Him to produce that fruit in you. You don't lose your salvation, but your relationship is troubled and not the way God has called for it to be. It's just like when Bonnie and I have an argument. Now, it doesn't happen very often. Now, we'll tell you this. When it does, it's usually a lulu. I'm going to tell you. But the truth is, she is a wonderful wife, but just every now and then she gets a little out of sorts. And Bonnie, that's what you get for not being here tonight. Okay? So just remember, it is a Baptist rule that when a person is not here, you can talk about them, and it's spiritual. Okay? But no, honestly, I got to be honest. Most of the trouble in my marriage has been me. I'm just being honest. It really has. In fact, the biggest trouble I've had in my life has been because of me.
Amen.
I'm not going to try to blame other people. Truth is, I'm the biggest problem that I have in my life. But when Bonnie and I get into an argument, I'm going to tell you, sometimes I can just make her so mad, and she can make me so mad. But you know something? We're still married. Bonnie told me many years ago, I will never leave you. I may kill you, but I will not ever leave you. I can promise you that. And you know, years ago when we were young and married, we'd get into an argument and we'd say ugly, hateful things. You know, I'm leaving, I'm not coming back. And one day we sat down and we made a covenant with God. No more of that. No more is there ever going to be, I'm leaving, I'm not coming back, or I want you out of my life, or anything like that. We made a covenant with God to be husband and wife. And we're not ever going against that covenant. And you know, it was really amazing because we felt the freedom to argue, knowing that we were still going to be there. Now, that's not to say that she might not have to ride up the road a little bit to calm down, or, you know, I might have to go out and shoot a few watermelons or something like that just to blow off some steam or something like that. But we're husband and wife, and that's the way it's going to be until the Lord calls one of us home. It's that way with salvation. We're a child of God. But when Bonnie and I are having an argument, the relationship's not the way it's meant to be. And it's the same way when you're a child of God living in sin. You're not excluded from the life of God, meaning the power of God, meaning the family of God, but there's problems in the relationship. You've got to make things right with the Lord. Because when you're living in sin, you are not allowing God to give you the rich spiritual blessings that He wants to give you. You're not able to grow spiritually. You're not able to produce that fruit. And the Holy Spirit's saying here, don't be like that. Don't be like that. Don't rob yourself of the opportunity for God to do in you all that He wants to do in you. And you move another room down that spiritual spiral away from the Lord and closer to destruction. And when you get to the point where you're robbing yourself and God can't give you the things that He wants to give you, like the understanding of Scripture, then what else happens? You're excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them. You're acting like you don't even know what the Christian life is like. We become ignorant of our own sin. And we don't even recognize it in ourselves. And the worst thing that we do is we try to justify it to other people and even to ourselves. You know, this is something we all can understand. How many of you ever said this? Well, I'm sorry, but you just made me lose my temper. You ever heard that? You ever said it? Guilt is charged. I've said that. You know what? Nobody makes us lose our temper. We choose to lose our temper and to blow up on somebody, and then we try to rationalize it and blame it on somebody else. You've made me do that. You've made me do this. You know, if I had a dollar for every time I sat to a marriage counselor, you know, where a wife left a husband or a husband left a wife and they pointed the finger, it's your fault. You made me do this. And I have to look at them and I say, no. It's true that your husband or your wife may not have been being the kind of godly husband or godly wife that God's called them to be, but no, they did not make you do that. You chose to do that. You chose to sin, and now you are trying to rationalize it by blaming someone else. We become ignorant of our own sin. We don't recognize it. We don't even know it anymore. And we just spiral down one more level. And then, when you've reached this point, you have a hard heart. Your heart is hard and does not allow the Holy Spirit to bring the pain and the uneasiness of God's truth into your life. You know, I had a buddy of mine that was a diabetic, and he had neuropathy really bad in his feet, and he was a welder. And, you know, a lot of times he'd weld these big pieces of pipe, and he was always real scared of dropping things on his feet. And I asked him, I said, well, I mean, I understand that, you know, but I said, but you're just kind of abnormally scared. And he said, well, the reason why is because I can't feel my feet. And I joked, and I said, well, I've been numb from here up for years and it hadn't bothered me a bit. And he goes, well, that's because you had dropped a piece of pipe on it and don't know the damage you're doing. He said, a couple of years ago, he said, I dropped a piece of pipe on my foot and broke my foot. He said, I didn't even know it. Didn't even hurt. I had no feeling in my feet. And he said, you know, it got into a mess. And he said, I almost lost my foot. See, that's what happens to us when we become spiritually hard of heart. The Holy Spirit can't bring conviction over our sin to the point that we're out there sinning, and God's over there going, you're in sin, you're in sin, you're in sin. But our hearts are so hard that the Holy Spirit can't do anything with us. This is exactly what the Word of God is talking about when it talks about in 1 Thessalonians 5:19, where the Word of God says, do not quench the Spirit. Now, if you've ever worked on a farm or in metals or stuff, you know what it means to quench something. You know, I've been working on, you know, a rear end or something on a car, and, you know, I'd have to cut a piece off with a torch. We call that the hot wrench, by the way. That's what we always called it, was the hot wrench. And I was like, give me the hot wrench. I said, yeah, you got it, boy. And we'd fire that torch up, and we'd cut something off. And usually, you know, we cut what we didn't need, but the part that we did need sometimes would be so hot that we would have to stick it in a bucket of water to cool it off so that we could get back to work on it immediately. So, you know, it's kind of like the old story about the fella in the horseshoe. I don't know if you've ever heard that or not. You ever met just somebody that knows everything? There's an old blacksmith working on a horseshoe, and he worked on it, shaped it, stuck it in the water, quenched it, laid it on the table. And this smart aleck walked up through, knew everything, picked it up, threw it right back down. And the blacksmith said, that thing was hot, wasn't it? And he goes, no, it just don't take me long to look at a horseshoe. You know, there's some people just like that, you know? But if you've ever worked around metal, you know what that means. To quench is to take something that's hot and to cool it down to the point that it's not hot anymore. Think about this. When the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, what did they say it looked like? Like flames of fire. And you know, to this day, I've got buddies that are Church of God, and you know, Church of God of Prophecy, Pentecostals, and they use the flames to represent the Holy Spirit. And I think that's good, because I'm going to tell you something. The Holy Spirit is like a fire. It is a fire that purifies you, but also, we talk about it. You know, when my wife is watching a Clemson football game, we say she is fired up, right? And she's probably wearing a tiger suit, too. But that's a different sermon for a different time. And Bonnie, again, that's what happens when you lay out of church, babe. Okay? All kinds of stuff happen. But, you know, we say it, but we talk about it. We're fired up when we, our hearts are hard to the point that the Holy Spirit can't penetrate these hard hearts and bring about conviction of sin. It quenches, it cools down the Holy Spirit. And, you know, we talk about quenching the Holy Spirit. You've heard about grieving the Holy Spirit. It's kind of the same thing in the sense that grieving means just what it means, to break God's heart. And both of those come when a believer sins against God and follows their own desires rather than the Word of God. But you know what? The Holy Spirit is grieved at first, but then the Spirit is quenched to the point that you don't hear God whispering in your ear anymore. You ought not be doing that. And pretty soon you just do it and it don't bother you at all. And folks, I'm going to tell you, that just leads you further and further away from God, because the goal of the Holy Spirit is to bring conviction to where even when you're in sin, you just can't enjoy it like you used to. Because God's constantly whispering in your ear, in your soul, you need to stop this. You need to do what you need to do. And by the way, that being able to quench the Holy Spirit doesn't mean that, you know, somehow or another that we're able to control the Holy Spirit and God's not able to. It doesn't mean that God is still not, you know, omniscient and has power over us. What it means is that God, for His own holy and righteous reasons, allows us to resist the Holy Spirit and allows us to reap the consequences from it. Then when we get to the point where we're resisting the Holy Spirit because our hearts are so hard, we've gone another rung down on that spiral. And we spiral down even more. Look at Ephesians 4:19. Once your heart is hard, it says, and they having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity. Greediness. You know what that means? It means that you just dive head first into sin without any restraint, without any regard. That you're so consumed with pleasing the flesh that you become almost greedy to please the flesh. You want more and more. And I'm going to be honest with you, pleasing the flesh, it's just like a drug addict trying to get high. It has its pleasures for a season, but then it takes more and more to give you that high feeling to the point that you eventually just become miserable because you can never please the flesh in the right way. Now, what happens when you've reached this point? I'm going to be honest with you, folks. One of two things happens. The first thing that can happen, and I want you to know I've seen it a million times. I've seen the guy that was on drugs, that was hooked on pornography, that was totally, you know, drunk all the time. I've seen this happen to them, where God overwhelms them with His Holy Spirit and brings repentance. And they're broken down and they just say, God, I've reached rock bottom. I know that I need You. And then you start that upward spiral back up. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 24 to 26 describes this. It says, the Lord's bondservant, meaning all of us that's been saved, we must not be quarrelsome. I think that means beating people over the head with a Bible. We must be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, and with gentleness, correcting those who are in opposition. Why? So if perhaps God may grant them the repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. So this phrase right here, it describes what happens where you have finally reached rock bottom. And folks, I'm going to be honest with you. I've had a lot of people get mad at me through the years and say, oh, you just don't have any feeling for my husband or my wife or my son or my daughter or my brother or my sister. When I looked at them and I said, you've got to let them go. You have got to let them hit absolute rock bottom. You have got to stop interfering with the work of God. Because when people hit the rock bottom that we talked about, one or two things happen. And this first thing is this, where they realize they can't go any lower. They realize that they can't get any higher, that they can't steal any more, that they can't get any drunker, that they can't mess up their life any more than they already have. Now that works both for the unbeliever and it works for the believer too. And they cry out to God, and God grants them the repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth. Think about that. That's a wonderful thing. We don't have to work up that repentance in ourselves. If you're a believer, the Holy Spirit gives it to us. Where we're able to repent and to change our lives through the power of the Holy Spirit. And then we start that spiral that starts going upwards. Because notice what it says, repentance that brings them to knowledge of the truth. Instead of being darkened in your knowledge, you recognize it. And you come to your senses. And you escape from the snare of the devil. But then, folks, there's a second thing. And I don't like preaching about this. But I got to, because it's the truth. You know, a lot of pastors like to build up what they think the way to build a big congregation is to only say positive things. And I would agree with them. That's probably true. But I'm going to be honest with you. My goal is not to build up a big congregation. My goal is to serve the Lord and shepherd those that God has put into my life by telling them the truth. And if you're joining us online, that includes you. Because that's my goal. Because one of two things happen when you hit rock bottom. Either you turn to the Lord, and God gives you the repentance that leads to life. Or God blesses you and disciplines you by bringing you home to Him. Folks, there is such a thing as a sin unto death for a believer. That's not a popular thing to talk about today. Because, you see, we don't want to talk about hell, we want to talk about heaven. We don't want to talk about judgment, we want to talk about mercy. And you have to talk about all of those. Because if you're not, you feel like every week you come into church, you just get stomped on, stomped on, stomped on. But at the same time, if you just go in and everything's happy, 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 you don't hear the truth. God is love, God is mercy, but God is righteous, and God is wrath on sin. And our sins are either going to be paid for either by the blood of Jesus Christ on that cross in Calvary, or we're going to pay for ourselves for eternity in hell. But if when you hit rock bottom and you're truly a believer, the Bible says this in 1 John chapter 5, verse 16. It says, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask and God will give for him. Give life to those who commit sin, not leading to death. But there is sin leading to death. And I do not say that he should make request for this. There comes a point where God says, you're my child. I can no longer allow you to live the way you're living in total unrepentant sin. I cannot allow you to destroy yourself because I love you. You're my child. And I'm not going to allow you to make a mockery of my name, of my holiness, of my righteousness. And when that point is reached, God may very well decide to take the life of a believer that's just absolutely an unrepentant sin. Now, this death is physical death, not spiritual death. Because if you've been born again through the blood of Jesus Christ, nothing you can do can separate you from Him. Okay? But here's the thing. Someone who has claimed to make a profession of faith, and they seem to have done good for a while or whatever, and then they just spiral down. There is nothing that we know, because we don't know the hearts of other people. And I'm going to tell you, it makes life miserable for their family. Because the only thing that you can hope and pray is that that person was truly saved. And that God just punished them and blessed them by taking them home and getting them out of the misery they had brought on themselves in this world. Or that person you may have loved may have just died and gone to hell. There's absolutely no comfort about this person's death. Excuse me. Because you see, we don't know. I wish it was like in the Left Behind books, where you have a little arrow going up or something, if you're saved. And all the other Christians can see it, and all the other Christians would know about it. You know, then you wouldn't be comfortable. And you'd be able to say, well, so-and-so may have died, and he may have died while he was in sin, but we know that God just punished him and blessed him by bringing him home, because I saw the arrow. I wish that was true. Of course, then what would happen is if only Christians could see it, somebody would come up with a tattoo or something, they'd use it to try to get into churches and do stuff. So, I mean, you know, I guess that's probably one of the reasons, but the greatest way that we can tell if someone is a believer or not is by the fruit that their life produces. But you see, here in John makes it very clear, there is a sin that leads to death. There is a sin that does not lead to death. And John says we should pray for Christians who are sinning, and that God will hear our prayers. But he said sometimes there's a time to just say, God, I turn them over to you. You do what you know is best. And you do what they need. Now that's a scary time. Remember that the Lord has saved us to be salt and light in this world. And to do this, we have to avoid the downward spiritual spiral. The Bible says in Titus chapter 2, verses 11 to 12, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, meaning doesn't matter if you're male or female or a Jew or a Gentile, if you truly call out to Him with saving faith, you're born again. And instructing us to deny unrighteousness and worldly desires, and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age. And one of the ways that we do this is by recognizing the steps of that downward spiritual spiral. You know, when I go out and check my tires, I check them not only for air pressure, but I look to see how they're wearing. You know, if they're wearing too much in the center, it may be too much air. If they're wearing too much on the sides, it may be not enough air. If they're wearing on one side, it may be that my adjustment, my alignment's off. This spiritual spiral that we describe tonight, that the Holy Spirit described through the Word of God, is designed for all of us to use it as a measuring device to check our lives. Which spiritual spiral that we talked about today? The upward spiral that leads us to the Lord, or the downward spiral that leads us away, does your life look like? Well, one of the ways of being able to tell is look at this downward spiritual spiral and ask yourself, do any of these points that we talked about today that the Holy Spirit said don't do this, are you doing them? And if so, what do you need to do? Well, it's very honest, very simple. First of all, admit where you really are. Get real with yourself and get real with God. Stop trying to blame everybody else for your problems and take responsibility for your life right where you are and say, it's not my boss's fault. It's not my wife's fault. It's not my husband's fault. It's not my ex-husband. It's not my mom's. It's not my dad's. It's not President Trump. It's not President Biden. It's my fault. Yeah. it needed. Then repent. Turn to the Lord and say, God, I'm wrong and you're right. I'm in sin. Help me. Help me. And leave your sin and start doing the things that you know to do. And sometimes we try to make up and say, well, I don't know everything that the Bible says I'm supposed to do. Okay, can I be honest with you? You're right. And I don't. And nobody else does, knows everything either. But can I tell you what? God wants us and tells us, I'm holding you accountable to do what you know you should do right now. And then I'm holding you accountable to learn what you need to do next. Get into the Word. Study the Word of God. Let God show you. But use the Word that God's given you tonight. And ask yourself, do I see myself anywhere on that downward spiritual spiral? Next week, we're going to be talking about the upward spiral. We're going to be talking about the fruit of the Spirit. And we're going to be talking about how God uses it to produce even more fruit in our lives. But in the meantime, my challenge is examine yourself. And make sure that you don't see yourself reflected in that spiral. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this opportunity to be together tonight. Thank you for allowing your word to guide us. Lord, we pray that if there's anybody that hears this word, that they heard your word and they're like, wow, you know, that kind of describes where I am right now. That, Lord, that you will just help them to be excited and to admit that, yep, that's where I am. And that they will turn and start moving towards you rather than away from you. That they'll admit where they are, that they'll repent, that they'll return, and they'll start doing what they know you told them to do out of love. Because they want to serve you, they want to know you, they want their life to make a difference for the kingdom of God. Lord, thank you for this opportunity tonight. Lord, work in the hearts of all that hear this. Lord, be with us this week. Bring us back safely together this Wednesday as we bring prayer needs to you. Lord, just work in a mighty way in our lives for your glory and our good. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Be careful this week, and peace be with you.